Și voi veți primi o putere când se va coborî Duhul Sfânt peste voi. Ei stăruiau în învățătura apostolilor, în legătura frățească, în frângerea pâinii și în rugăciune. Cu atâta putere se răspândea și se întărea cuvântul Domnului.
Hello and welcome once again to the Book of Acts. A number of years ago, when I was still a college student and I was attending a church in St. Paul, Minnesota, here in the United States, and it was pastored by my first mentor in ministry. His name was Lloyd, Pastor Lloyd. And he had a beautiful illustration one day to show what we're going to be talking about with the law. We had purchased as a church an old Jewish synagogue. We'd outgrown our old church building that was smaller, and we purchased the synagogue, which was quite a bit larger as the Jews were moving to the suburb and building a new building. And they had to sort of take away the synagogue aspects, the Jewish faith, because Gentiles were coming into it. But there were some things that they could not remove that were built right into the architecture of the building. But there were some things that they took away that the remnant of that was still, you could still see it. And one of those things was the Ten Commandments that they had put on the front of the sanctuary. In the sanctuary, if you were sitting and you were looking up, it was a high ceiling and there was wood paneling. And they had put wooden letters in Hebrew with the Ten Commandments there. And as the years went by and the sun came streaming into the large windows there, it faded the paneling. But underneath where those letters were was the original color. And so when they removed those old Hebrew letters of the Ten Commandments, you could still see, because the wood was faded around it, you could see the Ten Commandments written in Hebrew. Well, in that place, we put the cross. So one day, Pastor Lloyd stood up and he was preaching on the law and on grace. And he turned around and he looked up at where that place was. And he pointed out that where the Ten Commandments once had been, and we could still see them faded there in Hebrew, stood the cross. And Lloyd quoted from Colossians chapter 2, verse 14, where it points out that the law was nailed to the cross. A lot of times we talk about how our sins were taken to the cross. Absolutely true. Jesus paid our debt for sin that we could never pay on our own. He paid that for us. He took that to the cross. But also, the law was nailed to the cross. That which accused us and condemned us of our guilt, that was also taken to the cross and nailed there. So every time I would come into that sanctuary and sit down and look up, I would see an example right before me of how the law had been replaced by grace, that it had been nailed to the cross. It was a visual reminder of that. The reason I share this illustration with you today is because we've been talking about a dispute in Acts chapter 15 about the law and about grace, specifically about circumcision. The question was, do Gentiles who convert to the faith, do they need to be circumcised like a Jew? And we looked at that last time where there was a debate about that and they decided, no, you don't need to have to be circumcised if you're going to be a Christian. It's grace that saves us and not the law. What I want to do today, I want to do something a little different today in our study of the book of Acts. I'm going to step out and look at the book of Galatians today to do a sort of an overview of the message of Galatians, especially as it pertains to this debate that we see in the book of Acts. Paul's letter to Galatia shows what he felt personally about this particular topic. Now, if you recall, in Acts 13 and 14, this was Paul's first missionary trip, and part of that trip was spent in the region of Galatia, where he went to Iconium, Lystra, and Derbe, those three cities. We believe that Paul wrote Galatians right about this time, right around the time that Acts 15 took place, either right before it or right after it. And so I'm going to read some scriptures to you from the book of Galatians, sort of an overview as it relates to this topic. I'm going to start in Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. Now, what had happened was the Galatians got off to a good start in the faith, but they had slipped back into trying to follow the law, and they had started circumcising people as part of the following Christ. And that's why this was a very important topic to Paul. He got very excited about this, as we'll see right now. And here's what he says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? Have you experienced so much in vain, if it really was in vain? Does God give you His Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? The Galatians had slipped back into following the law. They thought that righteousness could be obtained, at least in part, by keeping the law of Moses. Here in verse 3, Paul says, after beginning by the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by the flesh? And you started in the Spirit, now you're trying to do it on your own effort. In other words, why would they want to do that? Why would anybody want to do effort on their own for things that God has already promised to do for us? That's a good question. Well, it happens this way. As I've observed churches as they grow and pass on the faith from generation to generation, as I've studied church history, this is what I've observed. And this is sort of an oversimplification to this question, but I think you'll see what I'm getting at. It happens this way. There's a generation that experiences a powerful move of the Holy Spirit, and lives are transformed in a real way. Their hearts are changed, and their whole lives are changed. Their lifestyle changes. And so sins that they were doing in the past, they stopped doing them. They had no desire to do those sinful behaviors. And spiritual things, disciplines of the faith that they had no interest in whatsoever, they began to start doing those things. They started attending church services and reading their Bible and praying and sharing their faith and other spiritual disciplines that before would have had no interest to them. Now they had this interest. And these lifestyle changes were spontaneous. They weren't forced. Nobody said you have to do this. It was a result of a change that happened from within. Well, then that generation begins to pass on the faith to the next generation. And it looks like this. They pass on the gospel accurately and powerfully, the same gospel that they received. And as they do so, they tell the next generation, you know, when we came to faith in Christ and our lives were changed, this is what we did. We stopped doing these sins and we started doing these spiritual disciplines. And you should do them too. And as the message increased in this way, they began to say, not only you should do these things and stop doing these things, but they required them. You have to stop doing these if you're in the gospel, and you have to start doing these other things. Well, then that generation grows up and they pass it on to the next generation. And the gospel is still part of it, but it becomes almost secondary now, because now the emphasis is on the behavioral changes that need to be made. And they put a lot of emphasis on, you've got to stop this. You've got to start doing this. These are the things that the gospel says that we must do. And so, yeah, the Holy Spirit is behind there to some degree, but has now taken a second place. And the behavioral changes becomes the goal. And these things are accomplished by rules. There's all these rules that must be followed, all these expectations that must be followed. And it's not the leading of the Spirit or even the power of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit becomes sort of a concept. And the main thing is the religious rules that are being taught. Now, maybe that doesn't happen in three generations, like I've said. Maybe it takes four or five or six generations, but you get the idea. Here's how the gospel gradually begins to be replaced by rules from one generation to the next. And when that happens, that's not life in the Spirit, like Paul taught. That's life beyond the Spirit, going beyond what God has required of us, adding to the requirements of the Scripture, which is exactly what the Pharisees did. You know, there's over 600 laws in the Old Testament. Impossible to keep them or even to remember all of them. And so what did the Pharisees do to try to, you know, help this situation? They gave even more commands. It's ironic. It's actually counterproductive to say you can't keep these commands. Okay, well then I'll give you a bunch of more commands to help you keep these commands. It actually makes it harder to keep the original commands. But that's what the Pharisees did, and that's what religion does. And it's still being done today. That's not freedom. That's not what Jesus came to give to us. That's not what Paul was talking to the Galatians about. Following a set of rules and changing behaviors, that's not freedom. It's what freedom looks like. So what does freedom look like? Well, freedom looks like this. When Jesus Christ sets us free and gives us a new life, sinful habits are broken, and we have a hunger for the things of God, and we have a desire to do spiritual disciplines. That's freedom, and that's all good. But when behavior is the goal, doing good and not doing evil, when that becomes the goal instead of the result of the goal, well, then we've just created a new kind of bondage. Where before we were in bondage to sin, now we're in bondage to the law, to a set of rules. And that's what Paul was talking to them about in Galatians chapter 5 now in verse 1. He says, "For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery." That yoke of slavery that Paul was talking about was not a yoke to sin, but a yoke to the law. Later on in that same chapter in verse 16, he says, "Walk by the Spirit and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh." The way to stop sinning is not to follow the rules, but to walk in the Spirit. And then in verse 22, he says, here's the results of that. He calls it fruit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace, and the rest of the fruit of the Spirit that's listed. I want to focus on love, joy, and peace, though, today. And here's what I want to point out to you. It's easy for us to confuse the fruit with the commands. Don't do that. Don't confuse fruit of the Spirit with the commands in the Scripture. Notice Paul doesn't say, be loving, be joyful, be at peace, you know, be happy, be relaxed. Those aren't the commands. The command that he gives is to walk, to live, in other words. The command is to walk in the Spirit, to live by the Spirit. Or if I were translating it, I would say live for the Spirit. Live your life with the Spirit in mind. So your focus is not on the things of the behavior changes. Your focus is on the Holy Spirit leading you and guiding you and living for His glory and His pleasure. And the fruit, the character, the results come out of that without having to do it out of our own effort. But when we try to produce spiritual fruit in our own lives on our own, when we try to change our character with our own effort and willpower, or by trying to satisfy some sort of standard that we're trying to live up to for religious purposes, we actually get in the way of what God wants to do in our lives. We actually cut off the work of the Holy Spirit in us. When we say, I'm going to follow these rules, we have to choose between following rules or being led and empowered by the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't think anybody intentionally means to live the Christian life this way, that is, by cutting off the work of the Spirit. You know, some people maybe live by rules intentionally, but they don't mean to cut God out of it. And this sort of thing is much easier to see in someone else than in ourselves. And so how can we see it in ourselves? That's what I want to ask you to do today, is take a good hard look inside and see what the Lord is telling you about how you're living your Christian life. And Jesus said, you will know them by their fruit. So I want you to look at your life and ask yourself, are you living a life where you're loving others, where you're experiencing joy, where your faith gives you joy, where your faith gives you peace? Because if we try to achieve the righteousness of God by our own efforts, by trying to meet a certain standard, that's life beyond the Spirit, it's not life in the Spirit, we're going to get terrible substitutes for love, joy, in peace. I want to walk you through those three terrible substitutes, and you can ask yourself where you're at and to seek God in response to this. Now, we know that walking in the Spirit produces love. So, for example, if we see somebody that's sinning, that grieves us, and our love for them motivates us to come alongside of them and guide them into making healthy choices. In chapter 6 of Galatians, verse 1, Paul says, "If someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently." Paul said, you see someone in a sin, the goal should be to restore them, not to judge them, but restore them. And if we restore them, we should do it in a gentle way, in a loving way. Now, on the other hand, if we're living life beyond the Spirit, according to the rules, the religious rules, and we see someone sinning, then we're more concerned about our standards being broken than we are concerned for the people that are breaking those standards. They're violating our religion, and so it's the religion that we care about and not the people. What happens is, when we look at people, we see their faults instead of their needs. For example, here's a classic example that when I was growing up that was in our church. We would see, you know, one of the things that we were taught very clearly is that smoking was a terrible sin. And if I saw somebody smoking, it's like they were going straight to hell. It was a terrible thing. And for sure, smoking is a terrible use of our bodies. Our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, and we shouldn't put the tar and the nicotine into our lungs. It's not a good use of our bodies. But we weren't really given any sort of instruction on what to do about this. We were just said, it's bad. Stop doing it. And there wasn't really any concern for where the person was at. The people who smoke cigarettes, who are addicted to cigarettes, many of them want to stop but can't. And telling them to stop it doesn't really encourage them. Many of them smoke, and maybe this describes you today, and there's freedom for you. Many people smoke because of anxiety or some sort of fear. Oftentimes it's related to rejection. And if we tell people, stop smoking, and we take away their cigarettes without ministering to the need that's behind those cigarettes, what are those cigarettes medicating? They're just going to look for a different medication. There's not going to be any healing that takes place in their lives. If we minister to the healing that needs to take place in their lives, the cigarettes will go away naturally without having to be forced or judged. And so when we see a smoker, when I grew up, we saw the fault. We ignored the need. Well, Jesus doesn't do that. He ministers to the need, and the fruit comes as a result of that. So instead of loving people, life beyond the Spirit, we judge them. And so life beyond the Spirit produces judgment, not love. That's the terrible substitution. Instead of love, we get judgment. Ironically, the judgmental person thinks it's spiritual discernment. It's not discernment, it's judgment. If it's not based on love, it's judgment. And when you think about a courtroom setting, a judgment is issued by a judge in a case, and that was all initiated by a prosecuting attorney who brought an accusation against the one accused. So judgment always begins with accusation. And when we bring judgment against somebody, that began in our minds with an accusation. Well, the ironic thing is that in the scripture, the accuser of the brethren is Satan. And when we accuse our fellow Christians, or even worse, judge them, we're actually doing the work of Satan. That's what happens with life beyond the Spirit. I have a friend named Warren, who is also part of the church that I mentioned earlier with Pastor Lloyd. Warren had been an alcoholic before he was saved, and this is some, I don't know, 45, 50 years ago now. And Warren, alcohol was very important to him. And he had a bar in his basement and all sorts of alcoholic beverages. And when he got saved, he went to Pastor Lloyd and he said, now that I'm a Christian, do I need to stop drinking? And Lloyd was very wise, and he didn't want to play the role of the Holy Spirit in Warren's life. And so he just said to Warren, why don't you pray and ask God? And God will tell you. And so Warren did. He went home and he prayed. And the Lord spoke to him and said, you need to stop drinking completely. You've been an alcoholic. You need to stop entirely. And so Warren did. And Warren grew and matured in the faith. And now he's an elder in that church. And he told me one time, if Lloyd had told me that I needed to stop drinking to be a Christian, he said I wouldn't be a Christian now. The legalism, the judgment on his life would have turned him off. But because Lloyd turned it over to the Holy Spirit and Warren heard from the Lord instead of the rules of man, he grew in his faith. That's why we don't want to give people rules. We want to give them the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit gives us peace. Whereas, and this is the next thing I want to talk to you about, is the peace that comes as a fruit of the Spirit. The rules of living life beyond the Spirit can be burdensome, not peaceful. They're burdensome on us, they're burdensome on others. And instead of the fruit of the Spirit, we get the frustration of the flesh trying to keep up with all these rules. And so instead of joy, I guess I'll save peace for a little bit. Instead of peace, instead of joy, which is a fruit of the Spirit, we get crabby. We get frustrated. You know, the world is not impressed with our discipline, but they are impressed with our joy, especially when we can find joy in the midst of difficult circumstances. That's impressive. So the question I have for you today is, your faith that you're living, or your religion, if you will, does that make you joyful or does it make you crabby? Why would religion make you crabby? Why would faith make you crabby? Well, sometimes people have expectations that aren't being met, either of themselves or others in the faith, and it makes them crabby when those expectations aren't met. There are many scriptures that talk about experiencing joy in God's presence. Joy is a sign that God's Spirit is working in you. So ask yourself, does your Christianity, does it make you crabby? Does the work you're doing for Christ, the expectations that you have for yourself and others, does it bring joy, or does that work irritate you and make you crabby? You know what crabbiness is a sign of? Typically, it's a sign of fatigue, where we're trying to live the Christian life on our own strength, and we can't, and we get tired, our emotions get lowered, and we get a little irritable and crabby. Nehemiah 8, verse 10 says, "The joy of the Lord is your strength." Joy is a source of strength. Many people use anger as a source of strength. Even in the church, I've been in board meetings in years past where board members became angry and they tried to use that anger to intimidate people to get their way and to get done what they wanted to get done. They were using anger as a source of strength. The Bible says don't use anger as a source of strength. James says that man's anger does not accomplish God's righteousness. Instead, we should use joy as a source of strength. And joy and anger cannot exist at the same time. Try it. It's impossible. Doesn't it make you mad when people get angry? I mean, that's just a classic example of how Satan gets at us, angry people making us angry. We need to stop that cycle and rely on the joy of the Lord. You know, in the country that I live in, there's anger management classes that you can go to. But Paul told the Ephesian church in Ephesians 4:31, don't manage anger. He said, get rid of anger. Don't use it as a source of strength. Get rid of it. Earlier in that chapter, he says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Don't let a day go by where you haven't dealt with it and gotten rid of it. Don't let it fester and hang around in your life. And in verse 27 of Ephesians 4, he says, don't give the devil a foothold. He's telling Christians that you can give the devil a foothold if you don't get rid of anger. He's not talking to unbelievers here. This warning is to Christians, not to allow the devil to have a foothold, which is what happens. The devil gets a place in our lives if we hold on to anger. We need to get rid of it. How? Paul says in Galatians 5, by walking in the Spirit, by living for the Spirit. So we don't want the irritation of living by the rules. We want the joy of the Spirit. Okay, now let's talk about peace. I jumped the gun there just a little bit. Let's talk about peace now, love, joy, and peace. So living life beyond the Spirit doesn't give us peace the way living life in the Spirit does. Life beyond the Spirit always drives us to do more. Am I doing enough? Are others doing enough? Do we have enough rules? Have I forgotten anything? And so we're always driven to do more, no matter how much we've done or how well we've done it. It never feels like it's enough. It's never satisfying. And so instead of peace, we get stress. That's the fruit of living life beyond the Spirit, is stress. Now, the Bible calls us the bride of Christ. We are the bride of Christ. So any service that we do for God should be an expression of love. And if we are serving God for any other reason other than living life for the Spirit, then we aren't behaving like a bride. We are behaving like a maid. You know, think about, at least in the country I live in, people don't really use maids anymore unless they're very, very rich. Traditionally, though, a maid was a woman who lived in the house with the family and did cooking and cleaning. And so if you think about the difference between a bride and a maid, both of them are women who live in the house. But one of them, the bride, is there for love. The other is there for labor. One is there for love. The other is there for duty. So how do you know if you are serving God out of love or out of duty? How do you know if you're living life in the Spirit or beyond the Spirit? Again, Jesus said you'll know them by the fruit. So if your life is one of love, you experience joy and peace, then that's life in the Spirit. That's living life by the Spirit. But if you find yourself judging others, if you find yourself being crabby with your faith, crabby with others who aren't doing their part in the church, for example, if you find yourself being stressed at everything that you need to do in the church, or you're stressed if you don't get your devotions done, then that's life beyond the Spirit. That wasn't what Jesus intended for you to experience. One other thing, are you seeing miracles in your life? Manifestations of the Spirit are supernatural, they're miraculous. And Paul said this, we read this earlier in Galatians 3:5. He says, does the God give you his Spirit and work miracles among you by works of the law or by believing what you have heard? You see, you can't live the Christian life by rules and then expect to get miracles. You don't get to get both of those things. You don't get miracles out of human effort. That's God's effort. And if you live by the rules, you've cut the Holy Spirit out. You're telling the Holy Spirit, we'll follow this list of rules. We don't need your leading. We've got this. Well, if we cut out the leading of the Holy Spirit, we also cut out the power of the Holy Spirit. And living by the rules cuts out the miraculous work that the Holy Spirit wants to do. So when we substitute the Holy Spirit for rules, we lose the miracles too. Life beyond the Spirit experiences no miracles. But it is very busy with programs and activities. It looks like freedom, but it's a different set of bondage. I want to invite you to really look at your life. Is it love, joy, and peace? Or is it judgment, irritability, and stress? There is an invitation to you to walk, to receive the Spirit. If you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit before, I encourage you to seek God for the Spirit of God to fill you and empower you so that you can live life not in your own effort and stress, but in his joy and his peace. And if you've never given your life to Jesus Christ in the first place, call out to him now and invite him to fill you and to baptize you with your Spirit and give you a fresh start in your life so that you can be that person that you always wanted to be but couldn't, the person that God wants you to be. Amen. Well, next time we get together, we're going to look at a very difficult story in the book of Acts. It's a conflict between our two heroes, Paul and Barnabas. They have a bitter argument, and in my opinion, neither one of them handled the situation perfectly. But what it does is it provides an example for us to learn from about how to deal with conflict in a healthy way. And we all have to deal with conflict almost on a daily basis. And so this will be an important lesson for us to learn. And we'll see that in our story next time. Until then, God bless you.